Very quickly, then in only 10 seconds. Then please don't blink the eyes, because if not, look at this, in this position, here, right here, the four blue car tick. Why is the name? Because there are, of course, four blue cars. But if I make something like this, one car is face up, the five. Another car is face up. The third car is face up, and the fourth car is face up, the all five. But if I make again, something happens. It's a jack now. If I make something like this, it's a jack, another jack. If I make something like this, it's another jack. If I make something like this, it's another jack. But some asking me, is possible not with jack or five with the joker? No, it's not possible. I don't do. Then in the other side is the four blue cards. But I can see red, say me. No, no, red, no. I can see green bear, no, red bear. Red bear, no, flower. What do you see? I don't know.
What the hell is happening?
Excuse me, it's impossible to.
That is incredible.
We're going to devote our energies to sports and gardening, all the cultural pursuits as far as they're concerned. In fact, we're going to put the goons to sleep. Meanwhile, we dig.
Greetings and welcome to The Anadromist. This is Byrne Power coming to you on a drippy day in October here in Tbilisi, Georgia. And I've been thinking about a few things lately that I'd like to discuss with you. I've been thinking about stage magic, and I've been thinking about propaganda. So we're going to talk about a thing called the magician's force. I'll explain that in a moment. And how it relates to the politics of the day. And since this is the year for politics almost everywhere, we have an election coming up here in the country of Georgia, but we also, of course, have that big election over in America. But this is good for any time, not just during political insanity. Before we talk about these things, let me just remind you, this channel gets no love from YouTube, partly because I live in Georgia, and my bank is not in Georgia, and there's a lot of things I can't explain, but basically I can't make any money, which is probably good, because then I don't have a lot, I don't know, do I get many advertisements on here? Do I get commercials on here? If I do, let me know, saying, yes, we see advertisements or adverts, as the Brits say, or commercials on your channel. That would be interesting for me to know, because I don't, but I always have an ad blocker. So the next thing is that so you can subscribe and you can do the liking thing, because and share it if this is interesting, because the more people do, the more my channel will grow. And it's had a little mini growth spurt in the last couple months for various reasons. But greetings to all of you who are new. But I am trying to figure out a way to actually get a few dollars off of this, and especially my new Anadrome channel, which, by the way, if you haven't discovered that, there are some new interesting videos over there. If you're missing Byrne talking about movies and stuff, go over there. That's where the really interesting stuff has happened. I'm saving this channel more and more now for discussions of political, symbolic, moral, meaning, nature, a place for ideas, which is what the Anadromist always has been. But seeing that I needed to make money, I started the new channel, and it's been growing fairly quickly. So yeah, and because I don't make any money on these videos, if you'd like to contribute, trust me, without going into my financial situation, I could really use it. And thank you for all who have given something in the past. Links below. Okay, so now that I've forced that on you, the magician's force, I have spent quite a while thinking about stage magic. You know, the illusions, prestidigitation, sleight of hand, danger magic, escape magic, spiritism magic. It's always a fake. All of these things. This started when I met my friend in New York City in my last year or so there, Greg Young, who at the time was a very accomplished young magician. And he really showed me some things. He did a trick on me once that just had me boggled. And I'm still a bit boggled by it, because he basically said, think of a card, and then the card appeared. I won't go into the illusion, but I've since been thinking, like, how in the world did that happen? But I actually invited him up to Alaska, where he did a couple of shows there. A very good guy. But in our conversations about magic, we often would discuss the fact that magicians were often very skeptical of various claims of supernatural agency in the world, because they knew how easy it is to fool people. They had different techniques that they could hold their finger over here and do something over there, and you wouldn't see it, because one of the things that stage magicians major in is the art of misdirection. So that two things are happening at once. One, you're paying attention to the words and some gestures, but something else is happening, or it's already happened before you're even asking the question. And thinking about that, it's interesting if you watch someone like Penn Jillette from Penn and Teller. He is always the I'm an atheist kind of guy. And in a sense, they are very much the old materialist, empiricist kind of people. It's like it has to exist physically or they don't really believe it. And of course, I have my problems with that. But one thing I don't have problems with is I don't have problems with using their techniques of skepticism. I mean, I believe in God, I'm a Christian, but I'm also very skeptical of so many claims that people make about so many things, particularly if they don't align up with the way the world really seems to be, and the world doesn't really seem to be a purely materialist configuration in my eyes. But as I've thought about that, and I've watched a lot of magicians on video programs. I've seen a few live, including my friend. I saw a magician in France once, and I always appreciate that. But I've also watched quite a few videos, and I think about it. More recently, I've been watching, not too many, but a few of the How the Tricks Are Done video. And the reason for that is because I'm fascinated by the techniques they use. And there's one technique in particular. We'll call it the magician's force. Or just, they'll use the word forcing, as in forcing a card upon you. But the whole point of the magician's force is to not, you don't know it's happening to you. Let's watch a demonstration of the simplest technique of a magician's force, which is two things or three things are set out for you. You choose one. Now, if you've chosen the right one, they will say yes, and they pick it up. If you've chosen the wrong one, they will say, okay, we won't use that one. And then they go to the others. Let's watch the demonstration.
In this video, I'm going to teach the magician's force. The magician's force is a way of forcing one selection out of two onto the spectator. Generally, it can't be repeated multiple times in a row. However, with clever misdirection and timing, it can work. So in this example, I'll say, suppose we have two packets of cards, and we want to force the spectator to have a packet of cards with the ace of diamonds on top. Then what we do is we say to the spectator, choose any pile, you know, one or two. No matter what the spectator says, so maybe he says one. He just says, okay, we don't need that. And then that leaves us with the packet with the ace. If the spectator says two, okay, so say, okay, we'll use that packet, we don't need this. Either way, the spectator thinks that the packet he chose was, selected or whatever. So, as you can see, the difficulty in it is if you say, you know, choose a packet, one or two, and they say, you know, one, you say, okay, let's remove that. If you have to do it later on, and you say, you know, choose a packet, two or one, and they choose two, and you pull this one away, they'll be like, that's inconsistent with what happened earlier. So some of the things you can do is, what I did there was I named the right one as 1 and the left one as 2, and then the next time I named this one as 1 and this one as 2. That kind of confuses the spectator a little bit. Another thing is, if you maximize the amount of time in between when the spectator is making the selection, that also helps, you know, the spectator to forget what happened last time. And that's basically the magician's force.
Now, that's the simplest kind of force. It gets much more complicated. I am sure that what my friend Greg did to me all those years back, it was about 19, what was it, around 1999 or so? I'm sure that what, no, he was like, he was the first person to visit me, so it would have been like early 97. And I am sure he did some kind of force on me that I wasn't aware of at the time. And let's watch another kind of force that's more complicated. Now, one of the things is when someone says pick a card, any card, there are two ways this any of those tricks can go. We call them pick a card tricks. One is a card is forced on you without your knowing it. It can be done through what's called bottom dealing or top dealing, or, you know, these kinds of ways of dealing the cards, or ways of holding the deck. So you point at a card and they hand you what looks like the card, but it's really the card they want you to
have.
Hey,
Chris, you know what to do. Go ahead, touch one. Touch one. That one right there, you're sure?
Yeah.
You don't want to change your mind. Okay, that's the one here. What do we got? We got the ace of spades. Say stop whenever you want.
No.
You're sure?
Yeah.
You're sure?
Yeah.
What do we got? Ace of spades. Go ahead, touch a card. Anyone you want. Right there.
Yeah.
What do we got? Oh, ace of spades. Okay, man. Say stop anytime. Right there, what do we got here? Let's see. Oh, ace of spades.
But there's also another version where it looks where you actually do have a free choice, but there's another trip in the formulation, or trick rather. A trip, it's a trip too, because you're tripping on it along the way somewhere. And you may not know when it's happening. One of my favorite magicians to watch, I've never seen him in person, and unfortunately he died a few years ago, is Ricky Jay. There is, you can find it on YouTube somewhere, kind of a degraded version of Ricky Jay and his 52 assistants. I highly recommend that to anyone, because not only is Ricky Jay talking about doing magic tricks, but he is also a historian of the craft, and he's explaining to you as he's doing things what Bartolomeo Bosco did with his trick, or Max Molini did with his trick. These are all magician names. And so he's giving you a bit of a history lesson at the same time. And he's another very skeptical person. I mean, a lot of these guys are skeptical because they know how easy it is, how gullible we are. How and also how slow the eye is. We often think, oh, I see something. And you think you know what you see. But as Hans Ruckmacher says, you see what you know. You don't see what you don't know. And what the card magician does is he shows you things you think you know. He's actually doing something you don't know, which is basically where it comes down to the magician's force. There are other techniques. This is not a magic lesson. This is a symbolic lesson on how ideas are forced upon us. And I recommend reading Ricky Jay's books. There's a book on dice, which is, there are such things as dice mechanics. In card cheating, there's a whole, you know, he says the difference between a card cheat and a card magician is that with the card magician, if you fail, people go like, eh, you know, that was bad. But if your technique fails you while you're cheating, you could lose limb or life because you got money on the table for this.
Well, we'll move on to the second phase here. I did tell you that I talk a little about false dealing. You've heard the term bottom dealing. Second dealing, is that something you've heard of? Yeah, you too as well, Larry? You guys have been around the block. Here's the way this works. If I had the ace of spades on top of the deck and we were playing in a game, I'd want to deal that card to Larry unless I didn't. which means that I wouldn't deal him the top card. I'd make it look like I was dealing him the top card, but I would be keeping it on the top. That's why it's called second dealing. It's an odd concept. It looks like the top card is coming off the deck, but in fact, it isn't. So this is something that one could do, and this requires practice. Now, bottom dealing, some people say, is even a little more difficult. In this case, you'd place four aces on the bottom of the deck. And again, I want you to see that this is not an optical illusion. The aces really are on the bottom. What I'm going to be doing here, this works with five or six hands in the game, but in this case, I'm going to deal my opponents a card and myself a card. His cards come off the top. My cards come off the bottom. This is cheating.
That's why, by the way, if you're ever walking down the street in a big city, this usually happens in places like New York or something, and I used to watch this in New York all the time because I already knew the techniques that everything that there's these guys called the three-card Monty game, and they often have three cards, and you're supposed to find it. They will have a person, the shill, who's playing the game, wins something, and so, for instance, there are three cards. One of them has a bent-up corner, and you think you know what's going on, but you don't know what's going on because the magician knows what you're looking at and thinks the magician is stupid because the card swindler, the con man, is stupid because he doesn't really see the bent up part. So he lets you find it a couple of times and then comes in for the kill. So the rule of thumb here is never, ever, ever play three-card Monty or the shell game, which is the same thing. It's also called the cups and balls, going back into history. Never play these games and think you're going to win. Anyone who does. And I had one friend visiting New York who did it and lost this money. And I'm just going like, you got sucker written over your head. P.T. Barnum's best friend, a sucker born every moment. Never, ever play those games. So because you think, you see, magic works on people who think they are smart. And here's one thing I can guarantee you. If you think you're cleverer than a magician, you are an absolute idiot and a sucker. You are the mark, as they call it. You're the person they're going after. Then we're talking about three-card Monty games and any kind of gambling game on the street where you think you're going to win. Just never do it. Pickpockets are also a strange variation in the magic profession, but that's something else. The card force. The card force is something forced upon you. There are different kinds of card decks. There's one deck called the Svengali deck. There are decks with weird little codes on them that you can't possibly see, unless you can buy a special deck at a magic store that has marked in all sorts of strange ways that you would never notice the patterns. There are blank decks, which I find really fascinating, so that it looks like a normal card, but you turn it over and they're all blank. My favorite card is the Joker, of course. And whenever I see stage magicians open up a deck of cards and throw away the Jokers, I'm going, hey, don't throw away the Joker. That's such a cool symbolic card. And in fact, all the cards are symbolic. And I'm not going to go into the whole history of it here, but they all have their resonances and meanings. And all of the images on there, the spades, the clubs, the diamonds, the hearts, all have a symbolic resonance to them. And card symbology is fascinating. It's connected with the tarot cards, but they are very different as well.
Welcome to today's video. I've enjoyed making these commentary videos about magicians that I respect, admire, and look up to, and today is no exception. Today we're going to be looking at the card magic of none other than Juan Tamariz. Juan Tamariz is a Spanish card master. He is known as El Maestro. He is known as literally the best card magician of our era, period. He's also taught Danny D'Ortiz. You know, we looked at that video at Penn & Teller Fools, and that was incredible. So I thought we'd take a look at some of the work that inspired Danny D'Ortiz and so many other magicians alike, including myself. This is Juan's book right here, which if you are into delving into some really insane card magic, trust me, it does take a lot of work. You should check it out. I'll let you guys go find the book for yourself.
The good thing is you win, eh? One of you. Then you are going to bet you with you. Eh? This time I don't bet, no. You and you. then one of you are going to win. Then only with two cards, it's not the card, only with the queen and the black. Three times. The first time is not important. Second time is not important. Third time is the important. Eh? Third time. I ask her. It's okay? Look. The queen. Queen. Here. If I make like this. Where's the queen?
On the bottom.
Very good. But it's not important. It's the first time. The third time is important. If you win, half and half. For me, eh? Okay. Because it's very difficult. Okay. Look. Remember. Eh? Second time. Eh? Where is the queen?
Still on the bottom.
On the bottom. So clever. But it's so clever than not half and half. 70 and 30. Okay? Because it's not. First time. This is the important time. Look at this, Dale. Eh? Look at this. The queen. If I make. Very difficult now, no? What do you think?
On top?
This one for you?
Yep.
What a pity, Dale. What a pity. Back for you. What a pity also because he's the other guy.
What's beautiful about this routine is that, the rules are, again, very simple. And all of the moves that he did were very transparent. In fact, he made a point to make those moves overtly not hide them. Whereas a magician would normally pull off some skillful double lift or something of that nature, that might confuse the audience. And the audience might be like, well, does he want me to guess here? Does he want me to guess there? It was very clear here that he was being comedic. But in that sloppy comedy nature, once again, the contrast is created to where, you know, there's a greater impossibility. The second thing I want to mention was the use of the money. Because the money inherently had, I thought, was going to be brought in as another decoy or a prop or something. And it was used slightly as a prop because the dollar was put over the last card in the final phase. And I think if that card was just sitting there, it would be a little weird. So I do think that. But I also like the idea of just having the money be some type of toy or object that the audience can interact with. Now they're touching things, they're making it a game, they're betting, it's chaotic, it's fun, and everybody gets to have a piece, and you feel like you have money for a second, and that's nice too. And so all of these things are really, really delightful. Just something to pay attention to.
So, the card force. You are forced into picking card, but here's the key. Without your knowing that you have. It does no good. I mean, some of the really great sleight of hand people will show you that they are forcing the card on you, which of course makes you think, aha, I will pick another card, and they'll still get you. Because, like I say, if you think you can beat a card magician or a gambler, if you think you're better than them, I guarantee you, unless you studied these things, you are not. And even I, who've done quite a bit of reading on the subject, when you start looking at how they do things, I'm actually getting a book in the mail called something like, 250 Card Forces? That's how many different ones there are. And they all have crazy techniques related to them.
Good evening. Welcome once again to A Man in a Room Gambling. This evening we will teach you one of the best things that can be done at a gambling table. Some people with a high moral sense use the word tricks to describe these subtle techniques, but we prefer to call them artifices. We mentioned before that it is important to arrange the cards when you pick them up from the table and square the pack, even before you begin to shuffle. For example, if you gather up the pack after a round of poker where two hands have been shown, one with a pair, another with a card of the same value as the ones in the pair, in that case, a mere glance is enough for you to arrange the small pack. You could, of course, leave them on top, but that wouldn't be very useful. Knowing two or three cards at the bottom of the pack is a big advantage for the expert gambler. When a professional is gambling alone, he will deal with putting the lower pack on top after the shuffle, or he will palm them while shuffling, or he might even jump a little after shuffling. what we call a salto.
A bit from Gavin Breyer's orchestral composition, but where he uses a man reading the Erdnes book on card tricks. And when you start listening to it, you realize, I can't follow this. This is really complicated. And a good card trick requires all sorts of strange skills that you would never think to master.
So there's a lot of things you could do in the case of this force, even if it goes wrong, even if they decide to not call stop until you're pretty much near the end of the deck. But more likely than not, based on the timing of this, you're going to nail it pretty much every single time on the card that they pick. Now, what I like about this particular force is that you could do it looking completely away. So it just looks like you have no control over the cards. And if you give an attitude of, oh, this doesn't matter, just, you know, call stop anytime you want, it really does seem like they could have picked any card whatsoever. And you could say at that point, you have a card in mind because you never took a card out of the deck. You just have a card in your mind, which is technically true.
And yet this is what's being pointed at you, these strange skills that you would never think to master. Again, think of Rookmacher. You see what you know, not what you don't know. And one of the things about card magicians is they specialize in something you don't know.
Well, as you George Bernard Shaw fans know, he said every profession is a conspiracy against the laity. Jeff, I want to thank you very much for helping. Larry, a nice hand for these fellows. Thanks so much.
Which has made them come up for scrutiny in the past. I mean, people have been doing all sorts of these weird little illusions and tricks forever. And at one point, these were seen as being, oh, it's like witchcraft. But there was a book presented to King James, James I, who was also the King of Scotland as well as England, right after Elizabeth. And it was called The Discovery of Witches, or The Discovery of Witchcraft. The exact name is eluding me at the moment. But we'll say The Discovery of Witchcraft. And the author points out that these people using cards and little cups and balls and nuts and all sorts of things they're hiding are not, there's nothing magical about it. This is a skill, and it's a very, very, very clever skill. So don't confuse this with the other use of the word magic, of making supernatural things happen. Although, in the history of magic, there has been a place where these things really overlap, and it's in the concept of the seance. Almost everything happening in a seance is an illusion that is based on magic tricks. And a lot of this starts with the Fox sisters, I think it's 1849 in upstate New York, which is at the same time there was what's called the Second Great Awakening. And they're having a religious revival. Different things like Mormonism and such are coming out of this. The Christian stuff is kind of escaping into, and you're getting these more esoteric ideas coming into it at that point. But what the Fox sisters were doing, as one of the sisters said later in her life, they were all tricks. And, you know, they had developed certain tricks of how to ring bells, you know, they would do it with their toes, you know, all these little things, but that no one knew. And eventually these things all got developed by the early 20th century. And then Harry Houdini, who really wanted to believe that there was life after death, would go around to these seances and bust them because he would ask to speak to his mother. And his mother was born in Hungary. And they would always say, we found your mother, and she starts saying these words. Usually the words are like, you know, my boy, I am proud of you, or, you know, have comfort, or your pain will end, or whatever. Something very generic. What's also called cold reading is what these people do. Cold reading is another weird art form. But Harry Houdini would always bust them with, my mother never spoke a word of English. She always spoke Hungarian, maybe German too, but certainly Hungarian. So there is this overlapping zone. But here's what got me when I started, the more I started thinking about the card force. When an event happens, the attempted assassination of Donald Trump, the border crisis and too many people coming in, think of any major event in the last 20, 25 years. What I notice is, for instance, Russia invades Ukraine. And at first, everyone's kind of like stunned. But I noticed within a few days, suddenly interpretations have to fall out into different categories. And everyone's living in their propaganda circles. So I tend to, I'm not in favor of the woke culture. I think all of that stuff is one thing. So I'm very, none of that stuff can get to me. But on the other side, there are the people who are, shall we just call them the anti-woke or whatever, the traditionalists in some regard, although some of them are very untraditional. And it's a very strange coalition of people who don't all think alike. But one group suddenly there was a card force. And the card force was everyone on the internet who questioned whether we should help Ukraine or not suddenly was talking about John Mearsheimer, as if he was the only person who ever discussed Ukraine. To which, having read a bit myself, I realized, well, this is bullshit. But most people, having not understood that, suddenly this interpretation started to grow. And it goes on and on and on from there. Eventually, the interpretation just rolls on its own. Likewise, October 7th, two sets of interpretation. Well, it's more than two, but we'll just say two sets, pro-Israel, pro-Palestine. And I think there are other positions you can take. But if you can watch this on X Twitter, if you watch people, I notice this all the time, suddenly everyone, you could predict who was going to react in what sort of way. And essentially, the card force is this particular interpretation. It's very interesting because we tend to think we don't have all this information. There's a lot of information out there, a lot of contradictory information. One of the things I really like about Tom Holland and Dominic Sandbrook's The Rest is History podcast is that they deal with a lot of the really messy stuff in history. And so you think that something in the past happened a certain way. We often get it. I mean, growing up, I became a Christian at the age of 15, and I'd read books about the Reformation, and you get these very hagiographies of studies of the saints' lives, which is a Catholic term, but applied to people like Martin Luther or John Calvin, so that it was just a very simple presentation of who these people were. If you stand back, it all gets really sloppy and messy. And that's the great thing about watching and listening to Holland and Sandbrook, because they don't shy away from that. But here's the thing, and even they make mistakes. I mean, I heard them, they did their one episode on the Beatles. And somehow they managed to do the whole thing as if the Beatles' influences were all insular to Great Britain. Of course, they talk about rock and roll from America, but they missed the most important part is the influence of Bob Dylan upon the Beatles, changing their whole approach to music. Now, why did they do that? Because they're living in Britain. They don't really think about that. So, for instance, on Facebook, I notice that many people who are, shall we say, 50 years or older, tend to not understand what I'm doing here. It's like, why are you making these YouTube videos, Byrne? Nor do they understand how much information is out there on these weird videos. Also, how much absolute trash, that they understand. They understand, oh, YouTube's full of trash. So they don't pay attention to the fact that there's a lot of long-form information on podcasts and videos and such. You know, people talking for 2 hours about one subject. That's going to be pretty in-depth. And you can probably find other people who take a different perspective. So what I notice is, and you really see this with the older men, men say, I'm almost 70, the men between say 50 and 70 or so, they immediately will come out with the interpretation, not all, but many of these people will be watching these, or watching and listening to the central organs of the mainstream media, which would be New York Times, NBC variants, CBS, ABC, NPR, those. And they will all agree, for instance, on the subject of Donald Trump. They will all agree. So these people have a rabid hatred of Donald Trump and think he's a fascist, which also then says, well, where did you get your notions of what fascism is? It's all a force. See, those people, as soon as an event happens, as soon as something comes, they will force an interpretation on it as soon as they can, and then double down and triple down and quadruple down on it over and over. So, for instance, it's interesting to me to listen to Kamala Harris. She's still reciting the old thing of Trump saying that there are good people on both sides, thinking he's talking about neo-Nazis, which he isn't. And I've gone over this in my big How We Got Here series. But that's still a force that they can't get out of their heads. Now, propaganda, and I've done this before, I'll put a link to it somewhere, and I talk about horizontal propaganda. There's vertical propaganda, is the stuff coming from top to bottom. So the vertical propaganda in most of our politics is coming from our news streams. It's coming from these organizations. So they all tend to circle around certain things with maybe something like Fox News or the Daily Mail or the Telegraph. Yeah, Telegraph being somewhat outliers. New York Post not taking that. But generally, most of the media that at one time was considered serious, is now very, very much not even trying to be fair and unbiased anymore. There's no more Walter Cronkites or Huntley Brinkley or these kind of classic guys from the past who did, even though they might have had a certain interpretation themselves, they tried to be fair to everyone concerned. There is no one trying to be fair anymore. And that's just as true on the right as it is the left, which is what is creating the polarity. But what most people don't realize is what you're getting is the force. And there's a force coming from above, from these large organizations and stuff, but then there's the horizontal force. And the horizontal force is what we do to each other. So it is this. It is my video. What am I trying to force you to do? I'm just trying to force you to think. I don't represent a larger thing. As you can tell by my numbers, I don't have many people on this channel compared to a large YouTube channel. I don't connect to a larger force. Even among the people I agree with, I don't connect to a larger force. I'm kind of always on the outside. Even among the people of the Paul Vanderclay, Jonathan Peugeot, the little corner, I'm still an outlier there, which is why my channels are much smaller than theirs, because I could focus my material, engage in that particular discussion, but doesn't interest me. What interests me is the things I've been thinking about for years, and hopefully I get them out. Oh, you know, I'm going to be 70 years old this next year, or at least finishing my 70th year. I am in my 70th year now. You finish the year when you hit your birthday. You don't start it. So that means I'm getting older. I'm going to die. I could die any day. I feel good. I'm not worried about it, but you never know. You know, I've had a few little things here and there that make me go, what's that about? I've discovered the value of prunes. All sorts of things. But the point is, I haven't got really a dog in the fight. I've spent my life looking at things and weighing and measuring things and trying to understand things, and this is what I'm giving you. You can believe that or not. But what I would like to say is, use a bit of the skepticism of the magicians to realize that you're being played often. And you're being played by people who don't even know they're playing you. Although I would say the people in the larger organizations, media organizations, and other internet companies and such are playing you. That is to say, they know they're suppressing parts of the truth. Which is why if I was going to, if I had any sort of advertising backup, I would say Ground News is pretty interesting because they show you what's being not spoken in different corners. But since I don't, and since I don't make any money, yes, you can contribute. Well, that's about it. I just wanted to get this concept out of my mind, show you a couple of videos, and make you understand that as soon as the next event happens, people are going to be forcing an interpretation on you. Your own people are going to be forcing an interpretation on you. Don't believe it. You know, think for yourself. Read more about history. Find good historians. And I have recommendations in other places for books. And I am not trying to propagandize you. And the propagandist is always connected to a larger stream. I'm not. I have my own thoughts. They don't align perfectly with anyone. And I'm happy about that. Are you? Let me know your thoughts. Do you think things are being forced upon you? Have they been forced upon you in the past? What do you think? Well, anyway, I'm going to see a horror film this afternoon. It's been such a good year for horror movies that I can't believe it. And I think it's because of the times. They are such uncertain times. A wonderful time for horror films. Go check out The Anadrome for some of my thoughts on this year's horror films. So, from Tbilisi, this is Byrne. As the Georgians say, drobit, which means basically, yeah, we'll just be gone from each other a little while, and then we will meet again. Nachwandis.
A people without history is not redeemed from time. For history is a pattern of timeless moments.
And the blow-ins cop the lot. Anybody have any idea what I'm talking about? This is the refrain from a 15th century poem. A poem by Francois Villon. It says, no matter how you earn your money, you're unlikely to keep it, whether you hustle or swindle or con or cheat, because in the end, booze and the blow-ins, wine and women, take it all. Suppose you screeve or go cheap jack or fake the broads or fig a nag or thimble rig or nap a yak or pitch a snide or smash a rag. Suppose you duff or nose and lag or get your straight and land the pot. How do you melt the multi swag? Booze and the blowins cop the lot. Suppose you try a different tack and on the square you flash your flag. At a penny lining make your whack or with the mummers mump and gag. For nicks, the dibs you grab at any graft, no matter what. Your merry goblins soon stravag. Booze and the blowins cop the lot. It's up the spout and Charlie wag with the wipes and tickers and whatnot until the squeezer grabs your scrag. Booze and the blowins cop the lot. This is William Henley's 19th century translation of Villon. Rich in the canting language, the criminal slang of its day. It talks about debasers of coin, short change artists, dice mechanics, card hustlers. These people are my friends. I spent most of my formative years learning the techniques of deception. Now, many years later, I can tell you that I believe there are more differences between the cheater and the sleight of hand artist than there are similarities. Take, for example, an evening like this. If I perform badly, I might suffer the disapprobation of the audience or an empty house. If I perform equally poorly at the card table, I could suffer loss of limb or even life.